Today we are here at the Smart, Safe and Resilient Mainports in Rotterdam together with the Managing Director, Peter de Bruyn. Welcome and thank you very much for having us for this interview. May I ask you as a first question, because you told me that this company is rather new, what was the reason for starting the company and what is its rather short history so far?
It was founded in 2011 by myself together with the Harbour Master of Rotterdam and the Safety Region Director. And our vision on the harbour, it actually started in the port of Rotterdam, and our vision was that there's a big gap between R&D and the billions we spent in Europe on R&D and development and the actual operational world of the main port. So actually, Jaap Lems, he said the famous words, why does it never land into my harbor? And I'm still the biggest harbor in Europe. So why doesn't innovation lead to results that I can use? That's why we founded this company as a foundation at that moment called Studio Veiligheid. It's a safe environment for innovation.
Right. Your company actually carries out initiatives that contribute to what we call responsible innovation, that is, innovation leading to both economic profit for companies and socio-economic solutions for all stakeholders involved. How do you do that?
Well, what you're asking me is solving one of the biggest issues between the balance between economics and social welfare. And how we do it is we use real-life testing. Together with the Harbour Master, as I said, the port of Rotterdam is a playground for innovation. And in this port, we have people living there, working in the harbour, but it's also one of the biggest economic places for profit in the Netherlands. So there is a balance between safety, between profit, and social accomplishments. So we use this harbour as a playground, and that's the way we do that. So we create events where we can test innovation and we can see what the effect will be on economics, but also on the welfare of people living in this harbour. So it's always a balance.
Right. Could you give us a couple of examples of these kinds of initiatives where you test or use the harbour as a testing bed?
Yes, actually one of the best examples wasn't actually in the harbour of Rotterdam, but in Amsterdam, which was during sail in 2010, where we used this event where all the tall ships are coming in and millions of people are coming towards to the port of Amsterdam. It's a big event, and we turned that into a testing ground for sharing information between public and private partners. And we could actually use this information for steering the event, but also for safety regions to do their business in guarding the safety of the event itself and all the millions of people being there. So that's one of the biggest, SAIL was one of our biggest accomplishments in the past years.
So it's also one of your biggest successes, I guess?
Yes, it was a success, but also we came to the conclusion that sharing information is very difficult, especially between public and private partners, but also between private partners together. And since then we've been trying, doing new events, other events, and trying to create an environment where sharing of information and data is a normal thing. But SAIL is still one of the, because we actually saved some people over there, having information on location of private ships, but also of police boats, ambulances, and we could all put this information in one big picture. And because having that picture and making it available to all people involved during the event, we could see the event happening real time.
Right. So what I would like to know is how you actually, if you have these private and public partners, and they have rather different goals, I assume,
yeah.
How do you convince them eventually to share the information, to share the data, because that is usually quite a challenge?
Well, for an event, it's easier, because an event, like sale, it lasts for 3 days. So we could convince by drinking coffee together with, this is the biggest asset we use, coffee. But we talked to the owners of data. So I talked to the high up into the ranks of the police department. Can we show your RIPS, which is rubber boats, which they use to during the event? Can we show the location of this RIP on the map? And they said, okay, it's okay, but just for the event. Mm-hmm. And we talked to the private ship owners. Can we show the location of your ship? And we talked to the ambulance department, and they said, okay, can we show the ambulance on the map? And it's all right for during the event, because they all understand during the event it's necessary to share information. So this is the way we did that. We accomplished an agreement on sharing information on a temporary base. Mm-hmm. And we actually showed that this could save time and money, but also could save people during the event, because we had a heart attack on somebody on a ship during the event, and we were, well, at least able to share, to save a quarter of an hour in getting to this person with a police boat, getting the ambulance on the right location, and saving this man. Mm-hmm. And actually, if today this would happen again, he wouldn't be saved. So that's an accomplishment, I think. Problem is that after the event, all information sharing went down again, mm-hmm. back to normal. Right. So, and we're still working it after, well, 8 years. I still could say, and that's troubling me, that at this day we would not be able to share this kind of information real time, mm-hmm. anytime, any place. It's still a special thing that we use during an event, and still during sale, if sale is happening in 2020 again, this information environment will not be in place, because you'll have to do it overall. You have to build the trust again for this single moment.
I see. Do you have any examples of where you have to share data, not only for 3 days, but for a longer period of time? And could you tell us about that and how you sort of convinced the partners then to share data, mm-hmm. perhaps with more than just coffee?
Well, looking at the harbor operation, obviously a lot of stakeholders are involved, from shipping companies to terminals like ECT, trading companies, but also the customer organization from a public side, and they all have to share information on a daily basis. And at this moment, they share only a small amount of information just needed to do their daily routine. Well, for instance, if we would like to solve the issue of empty containers, because every year about 300 billion euros are lost because of the use of empty equipment. We drag empty equipment around the world with no purpose, so we lose a lot of money on that. Mm-hmm. We could solve that issue if we would share information between competitive companies. Right. So that would be a dream. Mm-hmm. Well, so there we have an economic reason for sharing information. At this moment, it's still difficult. So on a very small basis, new businesses are started, niche markets, they share information, they start sharing information, and then they see, okay, business gets better. So that's having a better business, having a business case can be a reason for sharing information.
Right. But you cannot convince the incumbents to sort of share this information because they feel they would otherwise give away important information.
Yeah, I think at this moment sharing information is still looked at as a danger and not as a profitable thing to do.